Hi, I'm Iain, and this is the mess I created today. And normally what happens when I start a project is the workbench starts out clean, and then as I go along, stuff just accumulates on it, and then it gets to this point in the project when I really can't fit anything else on the workbench, and so I have to clean it. So, wait right there. I will clean this place up a little bit, and I will be back. There, it's all clean. So now we can get down to what I wanted to talk to you about.
Out of all that mess came this thing. And this thing is going to be the amplifier for my security system. This is what's going to give the dog bark its actual bark. And as you can see, this was created on protoboard instead of a printed circuit board, because I was basically making it up as I went along today, so I didn't sit down and create the circuit, and usually when I make things up as I go along, I create a big mess, and I did, but I cleaned it up. And this is the result. It works very well. It works better than I expected it would work. I don't really know how I'm going to show you it working, because I don't know how I would play music on it that you could hear on YouTube without having a whole bunch of copyright lawyers attacking me. So I'm not going to try. So you're just going to have to take my word for it that it works, and once I set up the rest of the dog barking stuff, you will get to hear it bark. But for now, you're just going to have to bear with me that it really does work. So, that's interesting, but this would be a very short video if that's all I was going to talk to you about. So I thought I would talk a little bit about the circuit itself. And the circuit itself, it's basically just plain op-amp stuff with some power transistors thrown in there to actually drive the speaker. And really, to talk about that circuit, it would take quite a while. And I don't really have a circuit diagram drawn for it yet, so the actual operation of this thing will be another video, but I would like to take a couple minutes and talk about probably the most, I would say, underappreciated aspect of any kind of amplifier circuit, and that would be these two things right here. These are the coupling capacitors that actually couple the input, this is the audio in, to the rest of the circuit. And you'll note that there's two, and in just a second I will explain why there are two capacitors. So, coupling capacitors, right there.
each one of those can be represented with this symbol. That is the symbol for an electrolytic capacitor. A lot of times people, including myself, get lazy and just say, you know what, that's going to be the symbol for all capacitors. But if you want to be really technical, this is a non-polarized capacitor. Both of the plates are parallel to it, not to be confused with that symbol, which ends up being a battery, where you've got the plus negative terminal that sometimes people draw like that. Other times they draw the battery like this, where basically you have multiple plates, and again, the big plate is always the positive. But we are not going to talk about batteries today. So those can just go away. Nobody cares about them right now. We're talking about capacitors. And these can-style capacitors right here, the electrolytics, they have this symbol. They are polarized, and that means it only wants positive voltage on one terminal and negative voltage on the other terminal. And you can see, well, I don't know if you can see here, but you can see that white stripe on the side with the little dashes in it? That marks the negative terminal. And that terminal has to go to negative, and you can tell if it's a polarized capacitor because it'll have either the negative or the positive terminal marked. Usually it's the negative, and it just has either an arrow going to it with little negative signs in it, or just a band with white negative signs going to it, or some marking to it. Now, what happens if you decide to be a rebel and hook it up backwards? Well, then it's going to go off like a little firecracker. And it sounds like a little firecracker. Well, okay, that's fine if you just have one polarity going to it all the time, and you can guarantee that that's going to be positive and that's going to be negative. Well, on the input of an amplifier, sometimes this might be positive, sometimes this might be positive. And what's going to happen if that ends up being the case is it goes pow. And the whole goal of this thing is to not have this thing go pow. So that is why I have two capacitors here. Because there is a trick you can do to turn an electrolytic capacitor into a non-polarized cap. So you basically take this and you turn it into this. And if you get a non-polarized electrolytic capacitor, this is what they've done on the inside. So what they do, and what I did here, this is why I have two of them, is you take two of them in series. And what you do is you put the second one backwards compared to the first one. So what you get is something really strange that looks like this. So you put the two negative plates of the capacitor together, and you have the two positive terminals out. Or you could do it the other way, where you have the two positive terminals in the middle and the two negative plates out. But at that point, it doesn't matter. What you've done is effectively turn this into this. Now, the reason you have to do this is because electrolytic capacitors have electrolyte in them. Wow, I wonder where they got that name. And this electrolyte blocks current from going one way, but not the other. And when you get current going through it the wrong way, it heats up, it starts boiling off the electrolyte, it bulges the top of this can, then all of a sudden it goes pow, and it smells bad. So what this does, this is not nice to to the capacitors. They don't like this, but they deal with it. And this is what you see in a lot of lower-end audio equipment. They do this exact same thing. If you get a cheap non-polarized electrolytic capacitor, this is what they do. So they do this. This is common, but it's just not real nice to the capacitor. So I apologize to the capacitors in advance before I soldered them in like this, and hopefully they forgive me at some point. But what happens is, so now if I really do put the positive voltage on this one, it starts having all these little positive charges. Ooh, look at those. On this plate, and it starts pushing the charge out of the bottom plate, and that tries to make current go this way. And before people yell at me, this is conventional current flow. Really, everything goes backwards in real life, but convention says current goes from positive to negative. So that's what we're going to do here. Who cares about physics, right? So it's trying to force current this way. Well, there is no current going from this plate to this plate because the electrolyte won't let it. It works as an insulator. So basically, every time another positive charge gets put on this plate, it knocks a negative charge off of this plate, and that negative charge from this plate goes through here. Now, you have current going this way on this capacitor, which is a big no-no, but because it only happens for a short amount of time, it's okay. It'll tough it out this one time. So it starts, and it's basically a leaky capacitor at this point. It leaks the current through it, and it just says, sigh, I'll deal with it, whatever. Then, if you reverse it, the opposite thing happens. Now, this one is in the correct way, and this one's having to deal with it. And so this is basically how they get around this whole polarized capacitor thing. And when you take this and you smush it together, you essentially get a non-polarized cap. Now, does this affect the lifespan of them? Probably. It probably shortens some. Electrolytic capacitors don't have the longest lifespan for capacitors out there anyways, so do you actually see a reduction in the lifespan? Probably not. And I mean, that's the way it's been done for a long time, and so far they don't explode all over the place, so I'm going to go with it works.